We know there's a grand jury convened, and we know that I think both of these people we saw today, Gabe Sterling and Raffensperger, have now testified before it. I think they waited until after the election, so it wouldn't count against them that they were participating. But it's just so powerful, the Georgia evidence. You know, in the other areas, we keep asking, well, is this a crime or isn't it, and can we prove intent? And with the Georgia phone call, it's more like, well, what's the defense? What's taking so long? I mean, this is not really ambiguous. It's a 67-minute phone call. His voice is threatening.
I'm Benjamin Wittes, and this is the Lawfare Podcast, June 22nd, 2022. It was day four of the January 6th committee hearings, this time on Donald Trump's efforts to coax, cajole, threaten state election officials and legislators into overturning their state election results in 2020. We joined up once again in Twitter Spaces to go over it all. In the virtual Twitter Space studio with me were Roger Parloff, Quinta Jurassic, and Molly Reynolds, all Lawfare senior editors. We talked about where this story fits in with the larger narrative the committee is trying to spin. We talked about what is working and what is not working in the committee's presentation, and we took live questions from the audience. It's the Lawfare Podcast, June 22nd, the January 6th committee hearings, day four. I want to start, Molly, if we could, with a question of why this particular line of inquiry is of interest to the committee. What does it really have to do with the 1-6 insurrection, which is a little bit more attenuated than some of the other matters, and how does it fit into the larger story that the committee is telling?
Sure. So I guess I'll make a couple of points on this question. So one is, I think you're right that connecting the events that were discussed today to the events of January 6th itself does take a couple more kind of steps than, say, the hearing last week that featured Greg Jacob and Judge Luttig. But I think it's really important to establish exactly what Trump and others, Giuliani, et cetera, were doing. They were really coming at this question of overturning the results of the 2020 election from lots of different angles. I think that some of the conduct that was talked about today on the part of Trump is where the greatest potential legal liability for him himself is. And then I'll also say that bringing in, we can talk kind of separately about the first set of witnesses. So the Speaker of the Arizona State House, the two folks from Georgia, the Secretary of State, and Gabe Sterling, who's the Chief Operating Officer, I believe, in the Secretary's office. And then we can talk separately about the Fulton County election worker and her mother. But bringing in those kind of three Republicans on that first panel, I think, is also really key to the committee's work to demonstrate that this is a bipartisan endeavor. There are two Republicans on the committee, and bringing in those kinds of institutional Republican actors to demonstrate that this is a bipartisan exercise, I think, is another goal that the committee had with this particular hearing.
Quinta, what are your thoughts? How to connect for you to the larger tale that they're spinning out?
I think it's connected in time, in that I guess it's kind of a flashback episode from the most recent hearing before this one, where we heard about the efforts to pressure Vice President Mike Pence into overturning the certification of the electoral vote. This is kind of record scratch, freeze frame, take a step back, see what was going on in the Trump campaign before that. And I believe that this was Chairman Benny Thompson set things up at the beginning, essentially saying, you know, this is part of a series of efforts by Trump and his campaign, that first they tried to stop the counting of the vote, then they tried various other lawsuits, other angles, then they tried what we're discussing here, pressuring state election officials, and then as a last-ditch effort, they tried pressuring Vice President Mike Pence. So this is sort of one stop along the line that led us to January 6th. And I do think that the committee did a nice job in connecting what they were talking about here with January 6th. So one of the election workers, Ruby Freeman in Georgia, who was threatened and got threats of violence in response to a disinformation campaign against her by Rudiani and the Trump campaign. She, for example, was told by the FBI to leave her house in the run up to January 6th. So I think it's, you know, if the, what the committee is doing is drawing a line between various elements of Trump's effort to overturn the election to the 6th, this is sort of one point along that line. I think in that sense, also, it's important insofar as it really underlines the role of violence, either threatened or real, in that effort. We got a little bit of a hint of that again in the previous hearing where we heard about the threats against Mike Pence. Of course, there were rioters chanting, hang Mike Pence famously. But a lot of what the hearing was focused on today was what these election officials and election workers experienced in terms of harassment from Trump and his supporters. We heard stories, I think one of the most frightening involved people breaking into the house of the son or daughter-in-law of one of the state election officials, of forcing themselves into the house of the grandmother of Shay Moss, that's Ruby Freeman's daughter, again, a Georgia election worker. And so insofar as, you know, January 6th was about a violent attempt to seize power on the part of Trump's supporters, I think that these stories of violent harassment ginned up by Trump, you know, with a wink and a nod, perhaps not saying directly, go harass this woman, but certainly, you know, pointing people in that direction really shows that, you know, this was a tactic that he was familiar with. And so though that perhaps that was, you know, came through in a different scale on January 6th and was directed against, you know, a House of Congress rather than an individual person, it was very much the same sort of thing.
So, Roger, Molly refers to the fact that some of Trump's conduct here is the area in which he may be most criminally vulnerable. I assume that is a reference to the Brad Raffensperger call and the ongoing investigation in Fulton County, Georgia. How do you understand the relationship between this set of episodes and the rest of the 1-6 committee's inquiry? And what do we know about where things stand in Fulton County?
Well, we know there's a grand jury convened, and we know that I think both of these people we saw today, Gabe Sterling and Raffensperger, have now testified before it. I think they waited until after the election, so it wouldn't count against them that they were participating. But I don't think we know. I don't know more than that. But it's just so powerful, the Georgia evidence. You know, in the other areas, we keep asking, well, is this a crime or isn't it? And can we prove intent? And with the Georgia phone call, it's more like, well, what's the defense? What's taking so long? I mean, this is not really ambiguous. It's a 67-minute phone call. His voice is threatening. It's preceded by a call to an investigator, is also inappropriate, saying things like, you'll be praised if you find it, and whatever you can do, Francis. It's preceded by 18 calls and texts from Meadows to Raffensperger trying to get the call because Raffensperger doesn't want to, you know, the whole call is inappropriate. It's preceded by he retweets a tweet from Lynn Wood, the lawyer, who his tweet is saying that we ought to be putting Kemp and Raffensperger, or that they will be in jail soon. And then there are the not disguised threats on the phone call. So that is really powerful stuff. I would also say, though, that all of the false elector, fake elector scheme is also sort of getting into criminal territory, and a little stronger, really, than, you know, just arguing that Pence didn't have the power to send back the votes.
So let me home in on that for a second, because I was actually struck. I have thought of principally as a Georgia thing, too, until today. But watching this, I'm thinking again about Judge Carter's ruling on the probabilistic ruling on fraud against the United States. and thinking that you have here a multi-state scheme in which the president is personally involved in at least two states, right? He personally calls the Arizona Speaker of the House, and he personally calls Brad Raffensperger to try to get them to certify fraudulent materials and send them to Congress. And his campaign keeps at it even after they refuse and actually procures fraudulent materials. And so I guess I'm interested in the plausibility of it from your point of view as a federal matter.
To me, it's more of the theory that could either be a corrupt obstruction of an official proceeding, or a more likely conspiracy to defraud the United States. But you see the campaign lawyers bowing out of this because they know it's not kosher. You see the White House counsel saying, no, this is not legal. You see the electors who got involved calling themselves, resenting that they were called useful idiots. I think there was evidence Trump was pretty directly involved in Pennsylvania too. You have Giuliani, there was an incredible statement, oh, we've got lots of theories, we just don't have the evidence, he tells Rusty Bowers at one point. And then the together with the fact that there will be this evidence that he knew he lost anyway. So, yeah, I think this is a criminal matter.
Quinto, what do you think? Is it, did your mind find itself drifting toward the criminal in, as you listened to today? Or were you able to say, hey, the committee's job is to tell the story, it's not a criminal inquiry, yada, yada, yada?
Yeah, I appreciate you setting up my own rebuttal to your question for me. Of course, that is what I would say, right? Like, we should take the committee on its own terms. Everyone's heard me make that argument a million times before, so I won't push it here. But look, I mean, I do think that insofar as we are also conceptualizing these hearings as a bit of a nudge to DOJ, it certainly did seem to me, I will say, without having taken a close look at the relevant potential statutes here, that it didn't make Trump look like he was in less legal jeopardy. I mean, I do think that re-listening to some of the audio from that Raffensperger call in light of everything we've learned, and in light of all the conversations we've all had about, you know, what Trump's state of mind was, it is striking to hear the anger in his voice, I think, as Roger pointed out, when he's kind of berating Raffensperger in the way that he says, we just need 11,000 votes. We just need 11,000 votes. There's also this really striking audio of a call that he had with a Georgia woman, Frances Watson, who was investigating the allegations of election fraud, which I don't believe we've heard before. Please, someone correct me on that if I'm wrong, where he sort of says, you know, if it turns out the right way, you know, everyone will be very pleased with you.
You will be praised, Quinta.
Right, right. And you know, listening to that, it really gave me flashbacks of, you know, Trump's comments to Comey of, I hope you can see your way clear to letting this go, or his comments to President Zelensky during the first impeachment saying, I'd like you to do us a favor, though. There's this very, you know, it's not directly saying, I know that I lost and I'd like you to, you know, rig the game so that I won, but it's coming very close. And I think that the ability that Trump has to kind of walk right up to that line without stepping over, we have seen in the past how that created problems for efforts to build a case against him, both under criminal law and under the different standards of press impeachment. So I would imagine that prosecutors in the Justice Department would face a similar difficulty here. But again, if you listen to that audio, as Roger says, it is really, really hard to come up with an innocent explanation.
Yeah, so I will just add to that I think the complexity of the Georgia case, to the extent that there is complexity, is that they're probably dealing with a lot of evidence. So, you know, if your Roger lays out, we think of it as the crime is the Raffensperger call. But if you actually think about it from the point of view of a Georgia prosecutor, the crime may be the pattern, the whole series of actions, which includes every text message, every call, every person who was contacted, and you probably want to get every single one of them in front of the grand jury. And I suspect the fact that Raffensperger and Sterling really deferred cooperation until after the election probably slowed things down. But I would I still think this is the area of maximum vulnerability, as I said, the maximum vulnerability for the former president. And I am really curious to see what happens with this grand jury, the special grand jury now. So, Molly, I want to back up here and situate this in the context of the larger story that the committee is telling. In the first hearing, they laid out a 7-part conspiracy, as Liz Cheney described it. We've now gone through a series of four, I guess, three or four parts. Where do you think the committee has been strongest and where weakest?
Yeah, so I think one of the things that I thought was really strong about this hearing was the degree to which it connected basically the content of the hearing. So this effort to pressure state officials to send different slates of electoral college votes to be counted, both connected that to kind of exactly what happened on January 6th. So there's a lot of emphasis at the beginning on the degree to which this becomes a call to action for those who actually went to the Capitol on the 6th. But also they were careful at the beginning to also link the conduct that this hearing was discussing to things that are still happening in American elections. So there was a discussion, for example, at the start of a recent episode in New Mexico involving a delayed certification of an election based on the fact that at least one of the individuals who was charged with certifying simply had bad feelings about the voting machines used. So they're really kind of laying the groundwork for establishing that, like, this behavior and what Trump did here to undermine the conduct of American elections is ongoing, and the consequences of it are ongoing. The other thing that I thought was incredibly effective, it doesn't even feel right to say that because it was so troubling to watch, was that second part of the hearing featuring Ruby Freeman and Shay Moss. And, you know, the part where Raffensperger talks about the threats to him and the Arizona State House Speaker talk about the threats to him, you know, those are people who stood for elected office. The piece of the hearing where Shay Moss talks about what she and her mother and their family have gone through as a consequence of, you know, them stepping up to do their duty to this country during, as she put it, an election in the middle of a pandemic. That I thought was really just remarkable courage on the part of her to show up, and just a really important part of this overall story. The last thing I'll say, where I think that, I don't know if I would say this is a place where the committee was weak today, but it's just a choice that they have made. So, you know, there's been a lot of discussion about kind of why have so few hearings, why not start the hearings sooner. This is a place where we saw a couple of those kind of sort of clip shows where they edited together a series of footage from depositions with various state officials, campaign officials, et cetera, to kind of tell the story of the breadth of this effort to pressure state election and state legislators. But you could have imagined an alternative universe where some of those people actually came in as witnesses. I think there are pluses and minuses to the approach they took. But that's a clear reflection of this choice that the committee has made to go for fewer hearings with fewer witnesses and rely more on produced video than bringing into the actual hearing room lots and lots of people who they spoke to.
Yeah, so I want to push you a little bit on that, because I think this is one of the super interesting choices that the committee has made. And I think it is unprecedented in at least my knowledge of the history of congressional investigations. It has the advantage of efficiency. You never know what somebody is going to say or whether you can force them to be a cooperative witness or show up at all. But you do know with absolute certainty what you have recorded them saying. And so you get to present the other variable that it controls is, of course, will they say the same thing again? On the other hand, it does have the look of making the thing a little bit more of a cut and paste job and a little bit more, you know, controlled by the committee rather than an investigative hearing where you ask questions and they give answers. So I'm curious, Molly, ultimately, if the committee had asked you for advice, would you have said this is the way to go, or would you have said more traditional is better?
So I think that conditional on the fact that the committee is really, and I've I've made this point in a number of contexts before. The committee is really the only entity that is doing an investigation as deep and as broad as it is that we will certainly see publicly. So we know that there's a grand jury that is sitting, that is hearing evidence, but we do not know what will come of that. Perhaps nothing. Perhaps we'll never learn anything about what was presented to that grand jury. And there are individual criminal prosecutions, obviously, but the committee is the only body doing a public investigation that's as broad and as deep. And so given that that's the world that we live in, and given sort of a choice that was made early on to gather a lot of information and then start telling the world about it, I think those two circumstances make this use of videotape testimony, I think, probably the right move. If they had called me a year ago and said, what do you think we should do? I probably would not have recommended waiting this long to start hearings. I'm really feeling like you're boxed into this strong, concentrated push. But I think given kind of where we are, what they're doing makes a lot of sense.
Roger, Quinto, what do you think? Do we vote yay or nay on the use of pre-recorded video? Roger?
I vote yay. I thought it was the right mix between live and incredibly powerful testimony and short clips to convey that these are not isolated incidents. It's the same thing going on in all these states. And I did think that the people they chose, I had never seen Rusty Bowers before. And but all of these people, I had never seen Ruby Freeman or
they were incredible.
Shea. They were incredible
in very different ways.
And it was very hard not to get choked up at some point during this hearing. And, you know, and it was all Jimmy Stewart sort of stuff, you know, sent Americans doing the right thing. And it made you feel good, but it also made you feel angry that they are going through this. And it's still, they still are. And, you know, when Shay Moss said, you know, none of those people, none of those election workers, the permanent election workers you saw in the State Farm film, none of them are still there because they don't want to go through this. And you can see that their lives are still upside down. And the human cost, I think, I mean, everything to me, and I know this isn't the point of the committee, but everything sort of goes back to me, to the criminal issue. And I think seeing all of these victims, this collateral damage to this preposterous thing that occurred, you know, you need accountability. And I just thought that was powerful.
Quinta, yay or nay on the canned pre-recorded vids?
Well, first off, I'll just second everything that Roger said. I will say I did wonder whether the ability to kind of use that pre-recorded video might have helped the committee present material from people who might not have been comfortable speaking in public or speaking that way in public. In particular, here I'm thinking of Ruby Freeman. So we had this sort of setup where her daughter, Shea Moss, was testifying in person with her mother sitting behind her. And Moss was clearly quite nervous during her testimony. And then the committee would cut to recordings from Freeman's deposition testimony. And I did wonder whether that setup, you know, might perhaps make it easier if it's difficult for Freeman to speak in public, given everything that she's went through, that kind of allowed them to get her on the record making some, I thought, pretty powerful statements about the way that Trump had unjustly targeted her and how it has really upended her life. I will say, going back to Molly's point about, you know, the committee waiting so long to begin hearings, Molly and I wrote a while ago that the committee was either going to need to start holding hearings before it was done with its investigation or wrap up its investigation very quickly. And it's pretty clearly chosen the former route, even though Benny Thompson had previously suggested that they had wanted to wrap the whole thing up before they started presenting it to the public. I have noted that during the last today, and I think the last one or two hearings, the committee has said explicitly before launching into its work, we are still investigating these issues. Here is our tip line. And notably today, they actually closed by saying, you know, thanking the witnesses today for their testimony and saying, by the way, Pat Cipollone, former White House counsel, we're still waiting to hear from you, which was very much a kind of, you know, teaser for future events. And I thought a quite powerful way of underlining, frankly, the cowardice of Cipollone's decision not to come forward in comparison to Moss and Freeman, who, you know, feared for their lives and yet were still here testifying.
Before we go to audience questions, I have one additional question for Quinta. Quinta, there have been over the last few hearings a lot of references to various people's oath of office. And this is a subject that you have been writing about since you and I wrote about it at the very beginning of the Trump administration. Talk to us about the role that the oath is playing in these proceedings.
Thanks, Ben. I appreciate the shout out. So you and I wrote at the very beginning of the Trump administration about how the oath is a sort of underlying moral principle of the presidential office that is sort of not thought of particularly often, and yet that Trump's own oathlessness really underlined. And so last week, I wrote with Tyler McBrien, who's Lawfare's new managing editor, and Natalie Orpett, our executive editor, about how the committee has talked about oaths itself. They've come up again and again. Chairman Thompson and Vice Chair Liz Cheney have underlined their own oaths, the oaths of law enforcement officers who defended the Capitol on the 6th. Greg Jacob, counsel to Vice President Pence, talked about Pence's commitment to the oath. So I think it's clear that we're really seeing this as an important part of the story the committee is telling. That, you know, they're pointing to people who upheld their oaths, and the witnesses today talked about oaths as well. I think there was some really moving testimony from Bowers, who spoke at great length about the meaning that his oath had to him, and that he felt that in asking Arizona to essentially undo the election, that the Trump campaign was asking him to go against his oath. So the story here is really one where the committee is underlining the sort of moral force of that promise that is made. And this is in sharp contrast, obviously, to the president himself, who I think it's fair to say did not abide by his oath when he egged the crowd on January 6th, and of the oaths also of all of those members of Congress who went along and supported him. We references to an involvement by Representative Andy Biggs trying to go along with sort of overturning the Arizona vote, and Senator Ron Johnson, who was trying to hand a slate of fake electors to Vice President Mike Pence. And those are also people who swore oaths. And so I think in underlining this story, the committee is sort of also implicitly rebuking not only Trump, but those other people who broke their promises.
Molly, what do we know about what hearings are coming next?
Sure. So at present, we know that there's another hearing scheduled for Thursday. This is the hearing that was rescheduled from last week, that focuses on kind of the efforts to use the machinery of the Department of Justice as part of this overall operation. And so that is scheduled for Thursday. We don't know too much about hearings beyond that point, but clearly the committee does have more that they want to do, more witnesses that they are going to bring in.
Roger, you have, during the period of these hearings, taken a little break from the hearings to go watch some criminal trials, which is a good reminder that the criminal track does proceed alongside these hearings, and they're, you know, kind of completely separate processes. Whose trial did you sit in on, and what was the source of your interest in the particular case?
Well, I sat in on the guy, Kevin and Hunter Seafried. Kevin, you probably know, sort of, that's the guy that had the large Confederate flag, and his son actually was the fourth to enter the Capitol. He helped clear the window of the first shard of glass, and they were all convicted.
All right, we are going to go to audience questions. We have the great Michael Bromwich, former Inspector General of the Justice Department, and all around a great American. Unmute yourself, sir, and the floor is yours.
Excellent panel, thank you. And this is a question for all of you, two questions. Number one, is it worth the committee's while to invite Mike Pence to testify? Second question, is it worth the committee's while to publicly invite Donald Trump to testify?
I will take a crack at both of those questions with two words, three words, yes and yes. Quinta?
It's interesting you said yes and yes. I would have said no and no, or perhaps an invitation, but with no expectation of response. I do think that Pence's own absence is notable, especially given how much we heard last week about, you know, his bravery in standing up to Trump, the fact that he is not only absent, but that his absence has not really been sort of remarked upon. The committee itself is quite something. When it comes to Trump, maybe my no is just an instinctive trauma from the drama of the Mueller investigation constantly going back and forth of, you know, are they going to try to get testimony from Trump? Are they not going to try to get testimony from Trump? They eventually, of course, decided not to on the grounds that it would just simply take forever. And given the time crunch that the committee is in, I suppose my instinct is that it might make more sense for them to focus on the information that they might actually be able to get from people who they might actually be able to hear from and persuade. But perhaps I'm simply being overly cynical there.
But Quindle, why not just issue the invitations? If they don't show up, it's on them. If they do, it's potentially fruitful.
Yeah, maybe so. I mean, I frankly can't imagine that they would show up, or maybe Trump's lawyers will physically restrain him from showing up. So, because I'm sure he would love to give them a piece of his mind and call them the unselect committee to their faces.
Mike, do you want to follow up?
Yeah, just quickly, and I'll break your rule about only questions and not comments. My answers would be no and yes. I think Pence is running for office, and therefore you get a much less clear-cut and hedging set of responses from him. As to Trump, I would say yes, because he has demanded equal time. And to Quinta's point, I don't think you would want to or even suggest that you're willing to litigate it. This would be a public invitation to testify voluntarily. If he says no, he shows himself to be the coward that he is. If he says yes, we're in for a show.
Roger, what do you think? Would you invite Pence and or Trump?
I'm glad Michael gave his opinion, because I was actually going to ask him, because I care more about his opinion on this than about mine. But for sure. But I sort of thought there was an open invitation to Trump. Am I wrong about that, Molly? Or
I don't know. I don't recall. I mean, I think just to go back to what we were talking about before in the context of the sort of choice to rely heavily on pre-recorded video. I think it's really clear to me, at least, that the committee does not want surprises in the hearing room. Mm-hmm. That they have gotten one consequence of the fact that Jim Jordan et al. Are not actually on the committee is that we do not see the kind of behavior in the hearing room that we saw during, for example, the impeachment hearings. And so I think the committee has just really shied away from having things that it can't control happen during the hearings themselves.
Teddy Wilson, unmute yourself and the floor is yours.
Howdy, y'all. Thanks for the panel discussion. I was listening to the committee hearing today. One of the aspects of the fake elector scheme that they didn't seem to dig into as much was the involvement of state legislatures. And I was wondering if y'all think that might have been a missed opportunity, or they might address that in more detail later, considering some of the people that are running for office, both in state lawmakers and also state elections officials.
Yeah, so it's a really interesting question. And I'll just say to kick off an answer to it, that part of the reason is that they are pretty single-mindedly focused on Donald Trump and the events that led to 1-6. That said, they did, you know, talk about the gentleman in New Mexico. They talked about some of the violent protests that they sort of argued presaged 1-6 in Arizona and elsewhere. And so I think they kind of touched on it without really leaning into it. And I assume the reason they didn't lean on it is that they're, you know, not a state legislative investigative committee. They're kind of charged with telling the story of 1-6, and they have a kind of narrative purpose as to President Trump, not as to any one of the states. Roger, Molly, Quinta, do you have further thoughts on that?
I mean, just in general, on things that it seems like may have gotten left out of this or other hearings, I will remind folks that we have the hearings that are happening now, and then there's the expectation that sometime this fall, the committee will release a large report summarizing probably not just what's come out in the hearings, but all of the other information that they have uncovered and found. And so I don't know if that will be a place that they take up this issue of state legislators more, but it is just a reminder that there's more to come.
I think that's right. I mean, it's, you know, we're sort of getting a report as the committee is still in motion and we haven't yet seen the final document, as Molly says. I mean, I also think it's a good reminder that, you know, giving a congressional committee the task of investigating essentially everything to do with January 6th on a unbelievably constrained time frame. They essentially had, about a year and a half since they were first constituted. It's just really hard because it's a really complicated set of things they're investigating. There are a lot of different strings to pull. There are a lot of different, you know, rabbit holes to go down. And so I don't think it's surprising that the committee, you know, has sort of left out parts of the story in its public hearings. For example, I was surprised that they didn't talk more about the resignation of BJ Paak, the U.S. attorney for the Northern District of Georgia, at Trump's bequest. So I'm hopeful that we may see more on these kinds of loose threads in the final report. But it is a reminder of just the unbelievable amount of material that the committee is sifting through and how complicated this story is.
Yeah, I will just add to that the, you know, the editorial decisions that they are going to have to make about that final report are very tough ones. In the context of, say, the Mueller investigation, you are disciplined by the evaluation of the nature of the special counsel's office is that your report is about your prosecutorial decisions. So you're leaning against statutes and the way conduct and investigated material lines up against federal criminal statutes. Here you don't have that, right? So you could report on anything from what's going on in state legislatures to federal law enforcement and intelligence failures to warn people, the Capitol Police, about 1/6, right? The whole world is potentially open to you. And the scope and scale of that is really immense. And they've presumably collected on a bit. You know, they've had more than 1,000 witnesses. And so, you know, they're going to have to make some pretty significant decisions about what they are and aren't at the end of the day writing about. We are out of time. We will, however, be back Thursday evening after Thursday's hearing. And until then, have a great day.
The Lawfare Podcast is produced in cooperation with the Brookings Institution. Our audio engineer this episode was Twitter. You should do your part to promote the Lawfare Podcast. Share us on all the socials, including Pinterest. Our Pinterest performance of late has been lacking, and I think that's because you have not pinned us. The Lawfare Podcast is edited by the great Jen Patya Howell. Our music is performed by Sophia Yan. And as always, thanks for listening.